Well, today is a sad day for us. Passing away of the first Prime Minister of this country, and who was regarded as the father of the nation, loved by everybody. So his funerals took place this evening in Kedah. It is our duty to pay tribute to this great man and observe silence for a few minutes and radiate, from the Buddhist point of view, radiate your loving kindness towards him for his well-being and happiness. Please stand up. You have 1 minute. Observe silence for a few minutes and radiate your loving kindness towards him. Tonight, so I'm going to tell you what the Buddha taught. You think it is very difficult for you to understand, but yet is very simple. He says like this. This is the English translation. One thing only I teach. The cause of suffering and the way to cessation of suffering. Just as sea water has one taste, so does my teaching, which deals with sufferings and its cessation. I will show you the path from the unreal to the real, from darkness to light, and from death to deathlessness. This is the message given by the Buddha. Now, if anybody asks, what is the purpose of his appearance in this world as a Buddha? This is the answer. There were many prophets, messengers, or incarnations of gods, religious teachers, and many Buddhas, not only one Buddha, appear from time to time and continue. There is no end. So the Buddha pointed out why he wanted to appear and how he appeared in this world, whether sent by a god or by another Buddha, or whether he carried any message from heaven, or whether he found out some sort of miraculous or mystical method to release your sufferings. He started his mission by realizing the nature of existence. So he started to think. I have told you the very day when he was enjoying as a young prince, that was his final birth. After fulfilling all the good qualities and virtues and knowledge and understanding and developing his mind, gaining more and more wisdom, he started to think very deeply. Why do living beings suffer? Not only human beings. Why do they struggle for their survival? Why do they try to escape? Why can't they satisfy with their life whatever they have? Why do they grumble and condemn and criticize and accuse and blame? There must be something that they could not understand. They are working day and night like slaves to gain happiness and satisfactions, but they never gain. The more they gain, the more they grumble and more they develop their fear and suspicion. Then where is the satisfaction? Where is the end of this existence? What is the cause of this existence? Who is responsible for this? He went on discussing all these problems with other religious teachers in India at that time. He studied under them. They have taught what they have realized or their views regarding these problems. But he could not satisfy. He knew that he did not get the answer. Some teachers told him, yeah, it is the will of God, you have nothing to do, you have to tolerate. And he could not satisfy with that answer. Some others say it is a curse. What sort of curse? He went on asking more and more questions. So one day, as a young prince, when he was sitting in his garden, he saw a snake suddenly appeared and caught the frogs or lizard. Now the fox is trying to escape. A snake is trying to swallow. When this battle was going on, another big bird came down and taken away the snake. The frog is still in the mouth. Then he started to think, this is the nature of existence. Every living being on this earth, in the water, in the air, having an endless battle, a struggle for survival, at the same time a struggle to escape. Each and every living being depend on other living beings, prey on, P-R-E-Y, prey on the other living being and catch them. Others try to escape. At the same time, this world is known as Kama Loka, sensual world. The whole universe divided into three, according to the Buddha, Kama Loka, Rupa Loka, Arupa Loka, where living beings exist. And this is called Kama Loka, humans and animals try to indulge or to entertain their senses by gaining more and more pleasure. That is the main cause for all our problems, struggle, battle, war, violence, bloodshed. In fact, the whole world is in chaotic condition, battlefield today, because of this. They are not creating violence and bloodshed just because they want to survive. They have enough food, clothing, shelters, but cannot satisfy. They need more and more. That is what Mahatma Gandhi in India once has said. Here in this world, we have more than enough things for our needs. But not for our craving. Craving cannot find out things to satisfy our life. But for our survival, for our requisite, for our necessities, still we have more than enough. So there is no reason for us to fight or disturb others because of that extraordinary pleasure. Even animals also disturb others. But we must give credit to animals. They kill and destroy other living beings mostly for their survival. Otherwise, they don't want to disturb. At the same time, they disturb or destroy only certain groups of living beings, but not each and every living being. But human beings are the most dangerous, most cruel living beings in this world. They have no sympathy. They have no kindness. They can destroy every living being on this earth and in the world. But other living beings never do that. Bertrand Russell, one of the best philosophers, yet a free thinker who had no religion, he says, "I really cannot understand why human beings are superior to animals. We haven't got enough evidence to prove that we are higher or superior to animals. When you study way of life of animals and humans, cruelty, cunningness, violence for unnecessary things, jealousy, grudge, evil, hatred, all these things we can find in human mind, but not in animals' mind. They destroy, they don't destroy, they catch and eat other living beings for their food, that's all. But for fun, we go for hunting animals and fishing, just throw away after catching them. That is the fun, that is the wonderful happiness we gain. How can we say we are advanced
or we have religion to glorify, we are higher than, because we pray and worship. We pray and worship because of fear, or to escape from punishment. Otherwise we never do that also. Animals never pray, never worship, they have no religion. But they follow the natural way of life, nature. They never violate the natural way of life. We have violated everything. Nature and atmosphere, water, air, and beauties, natural beauty, hills and jungles and forests. Animals never destroy these things. For our satisfaction, without considering that they are damaging this world. We say we are developing this country. Actually, we never, never develop this country or any country. We destroy everything for our satisfaction. There will be a day that we won't be able to live on this earth because of our behavior. Other living beings never do such disaster. Why do we need a religion? Other living beings can live very well without any religion. But we cannot live peacefully, happily, although we have a religion to glorify or to fight by using the name of religion. Our religion is higher than your religion. If you do not accept our religion, you go to hell. This is the human mind. But religion is needed. Why? Cunningness and intelligence. Cunningness appears when the mind is developed. In crooked way, combined with selfishness. But in other living beings, you cannot find that kindness, that selfishness in crooked way. That is why religion is needed to straighten that crookedness from the human mind. Because science and technology and various modern subjects also cannot do anything for that. People become more cunning and more crooked and more wicked because of science and technology. Because they take the advantage of this technique, create more troubles, more problems and more disaster. That is the nature of the development of human mind. So religion is the only solution to train the cunning and crooked or wicked mind. So animals can live without any religion. Can you imagine if all those human beings behave very selfish, very cunning, very crooked, or very cruel way with their own respective religion? What would be the situations of human mind if there is no religion? Because every religion, irrespective of their religious labels, try to train human beings to live as real human beings, cultured human beings, civilized human being, noble human being. This is the duty of a religion. Even then, man is so cunning and so selfish, he uses religion also for that purpose, for the personal benefit, personal gain. Very cunning way they use the name of religion. So religions and religions also fight because of this. People have no peace because of religions. In certain countries, people lived for 40 to 50 years without any religion. Some people say, I do not know whether they are right or wrong, some people say they are living peacefully because they have no religion. But in other countries where there are different religions, people have no peace because of religion, they say. But after leading a life for more than 40 to 50 years, they realized that something is missing in them. By force they try to topple and destroy religions, religious buildings, religious articles, everything. But they realized recently that religion is important. Religious way of life is important. Otherwise, no one can control a human mind. Although they make mistake, but still, religion is important to reduce certain immoral and wicked and cruel and dangerous things. In the name of God, or because of fear of punishment, or fear of hell, they stop very dangerous and wicked things because of religion. If there is no religion, they can do anything whatever they like, nobody to control them. Now we can understand the nature of human life. Why do we need a religion? So the Buddha, before gaining his enlightenment, by realizing this existing or eternal problem, he wanted to find out whether there is any solution to see the end of this battle. Now you work very hard, you earn, you enjoy your life, at the same time you attend to certain religious services, but there are worries and miseries and problems and fear and suspicions and unsatisfactoriness in your mind. Every day you are going on grumbling, accusing, blaming, at the same time disturbing. Now this is the nature of human life. When we come to religion, we can reduce that crazy attitude, selfishness, and realize the danger of cruelty and suffering that we create. You cannot learn these things from science and technology and various other subjects. these subjects enrich our knowledge to gain more worldly knowledge. But there is no proper discipline, a mental training. So the trouble is, we have been working for material development and to gain more and more pleasure. We have developed material and worldly life, at the same time disregarded the noble way of life. So the material development and spiritual degeneration. Now this is the main cause of our problem. We have become slaves for worldly things by disregarding all the great qualities and the virtues or noble way of life. At the same time, we also go and pray, thinking we can see the end of our sufferings and problems and troubles and sicknesses simply by praying. So far, no one could gain that simply by praying to anybody. That is why the Buddha was not interested. He may encourage anybody to come and even worship him or pray to him. That is what he says here. I teach you only one thing. For you to understand the nature of your life, where sufferings exist, and to tell you how to see the end of your suffering. That's so. That is my mission. I did not come here to tell you who created this world and who created you and where is the beginning of this world or this universe. He said, I am not interested. These are not the important thing for you to see the end of your suffering. Wherever you can go on arguing regarding the beginning of your life, beginning of this world, beginning of this universe, you create your own imagination and you never get the answer and you never get the chance to see the end of your problems and suffering. He says, stop all these things. Start from today onward. Analyze. Observe. See what is happening in this world. Without depending on any holy books. This whole world is a holy book. Open your eyes and see what is happening. Use your common sense. You have human mind to think, but you have not given this chance for your mind to think freely. Always you depend on somebody or something. Now this is the advice given by the Buddha. Don't depend on God, don't depend on Buddha, don't depend on holy book. Use your common sense. The method taught by the unbiased, noble religious teachers, analyze. Try to understand. Those who make mistake, those who commit evils, know very well that they are doing wrong thing. That is why they go and hide That is why they do such things secretly. So it is not their ignorance. It is not that they are innocent. They know. Only thing, they have not realized the danger of violence and sufferings and miseries and disturbances that they create through their violence and cruel method. If they think for a short while, they can understand. Without depending on anybody, a simple example that the Buddha has given for you to understand the danger of destroying others' life. To the Buddha, it is not a religious law. It is not a commandment. It is natural. All these good and bad things are natural. So our duty is to understand amongst those natural occurrences what are the right things, what are the bad things. By realizing this, then try to avoid bad things, cultivate good things. That is his technique. Not necessary to depend on others. He says, if you cannot understand why killing is bad, you can say, oh, I don't like to kill. If I kill, God will punish me. That is selfishness. Because of your punishment, you don't want to kill others. Otherwise, you can kill if there is no such punishment. Where is the understanding? Where is your kindness and compassion? You abuse your intelligence if you say like that. You must say, I know it is bad, I know it is cruel, I know it creates suffering. Therefore, I don't like to kill. And then you realize something. So what the Buddha says? If you cannot understand why killing is bad, then think in this way. When another person comes and tries to kill you, how do you feel? It's necessary for you to read your holy books to understand how you feel at that time, why it is bad. When another person comes and tries to kill you, how are you sure what sort of sufferings and tension you have to face? So if you try to kill another person, and that person, that living beings also get the same feeling. Remember this. That is more than enough for you to understand why it is bad. Now this is his way of teaching. Here. One thing only I teach. Just now I told you he was not interested in any of those metaphysical and hair-splitting argument about the world and the universe, or how many stars are there in one galaxy. That is not his duty to count them. In fact, he was not interested whether God exists or not. To him, it is not important. If God exists, let him exist. If God does not exist, we can do our work. Why bother about that? That is his way of teaching. We must know how to do our duty without depending on anybody. What is happening? We neglect our duty and depend on somebody else. That is the mistake. Here, the cause of suffering and end of suffering. Only two things, but one message. What is the cause of our suffering? We do not agree with that interpretation given by other religions, that we have to suffer in this world because of our original sin. We don't agree with that. Not only original sin, every day we are sinning. Lot of new sins also there. Not only old sins. Every day we are committing evil. The cause of our suffering, as I mentioned, not only human beings, animals also suffer in the same way. Sicknesses, old age, death. Not because of their original sin. It is natural. Plant life also suffer. Old age, sicknesses, death. Not because of their original sin. Natural. Combinations of elements, combinations of energies, combinations of mental energies, conditions produce living things or living beings. When they combine together, these component things, when you analyze, you can see friction, elements and elements, elements and energies, clashes, imbalance, disagreement. So we have to face unsatisfactoriness, pain, sufferings, ache, old age, sicknesses, death, because of this friction. There is no God behind, there is no devil behind. This is the nature. But the Buddha has pointed out another important point, psychological. This is for mostly for human beings. We suffer more because of our craving, because of our selfishness. This you can understand very clearly. The very day when you withdraw or eradicate your craving and selfishness, fear disappears. Jealousy disappear, suspicions disappear, and craze that we develop in our mind to gain this and that, which create restlessness, unsatisfactoriness, all disappear. The more we develop our craving, the more we suffer physically and mentally. When the mind is affected, when the mind is polluted, when the mind is disturbed, the whole physical system, physical body also affected. Then later turn into various sicknesses which create sufferings. So many of our sicknesses are created by our mind. Polluted mind. If the mind is pure, if we can reduce our craving and selfishness, then we reduce mental pollution. We can maintain contentment. santutti paramam dana. Contentment is the highest wealth according to the Buddha. Example, a man who had been working so hard day and night, bluffing, swindling, cheating, creating violence and bloodshed to become a multi-millionaire. Now he is very rich, but still there is no contentment. He is suffering from fear and unsatisfactoriness and jealousy and suspicion. Now his life also in danger. No satisfaction. Another poor man. He realized that this is enough for me. I don't want to crave anymore. I have enough food. I have a shelter for me to live. I have clothing. I have medicine. What else? I can satisfy with this. Then he reduced all the dirty thing, dangerous thing that appear in the mind, jealousy, anger, hatred, enmity, evil, grudge, all disappear from the mind. I remember the well-known saying, a Chinese poem, beautiful saying of a poor man in China. He says, I have my paddy field for me to get enough rice to eat. I have my well to get enough water to drink and take bath. I have my hut for me to rest and sleep. Morning I go out and work. Evening I come back and rest. Why do I worry about a king or emperors or rulers? Because I am not doing anything wrong. I can satisfy with my life. I don't depend on them. I can satisfy. That man can satisfy. You may think he is a foolish man. But you think you are wise, but you have fear and suspicion and jealousy and hatred and enmity and everything. But you are wise. You think you are wise. So by realizing this, the Buddha said, santutti paramangdhanam, cultivate some sort of contentment in your life. Then you can reduce a lot of problems that you are facing. There won't be enemies to disturb you. And people never suspect you for anything. They never blame you because they have seen your contentment, your satisfaction in your life. So according to the Buddha, the main cause of our suffering is our own craving. This we can understand the day when we completely eradicate this craving, selfishness. Then he has taught us the method how to work to reduce this. You cannot wash away or wipe out. You cannot wash away your craving and selfishness by praying to Buddha or by praying to any god, unless you realize when you cultivate your contentment, you never disturb others. You never interfere or interrupt or disturb others. The trouble with us, we cannot live without disturbing others, either mentally or verbally or physically. Some sort of disturbances we create. But when you cultivate this contentment, such thought, such word, such action, no more, then others also can live peacefully. Then they respect you, they trust you. Thought, such word, such action, no more, then others also can live peacefully. Then they respect you, they trust you. Now you can see why people pay respect or support to religious people. Whether they are good or bad, whether they are honest or not, the general impression is that religious people are contented people, honest people, harmless people. In appreciation of these virtues, development of these virtues, they respect. Not because of fear, not because of anything else, in honor of their development. You think they are very honest people, they never bluff you. You think they are very kind, they never disturb you. So when we cultivate all these good qualities, then the mind become pure. And this is the method introduced by the Buddha. If you don't like to see physical and mental sufferings anymore, when the life come into existence again and again, you also can go on reducing and reducing and reducing until you reach your final goal. Then the method taught by the Buddha is Eight Noble Paths. The religious rites and rituals and ceremonies and prayers and offerings and recitals and chantings were organized by us, not introduced by the Buddha. The Buddha was not interested in any of these activities. If you say, I don't like to worship you, but I like to follow the advice given by you, then the Buddha says, you are the real follower of the Buddha. You directly say, I don't want to worship you, but I respect you, I follow your advice. That is what the Buddha wanted. The method given by him for us to test, he says, I am telling you according to my own experience. It is not a message given to me by another Buddha or another God. My own experience. I can understand how I had to suffer during my so many previous births, just because of the mistakes or the bad things that I have committed. Then I realized that these things are bad. By realizing this, I tried to avoid as much as possible.
can understand how I enjoyed my life, what sort of pleasurable, peaceful, happy life I had because of the good deeds that I have done. This is my experience. If you cannot understand, if you don't trust me, you also can practice, then you can see the result. Do certain bad things, you have to face the consequences. Do some good deeds. Definitely, you gain some sort of happiness. This is the nature of his message. He says, simply by worshipping or praying to anybody, praising, you won't gain what you want. Example is given. You say it is like this. When you are sick, you go and see a doctor or a physician. He gives you a prescription or a medicine. You come back and keep this medicine or prescription in your drawer, and you start to worship and pray to that doctor, praising he is a very learned doctor, he's a specialist, he can cure any kind of sickness, but you never take the medicine. Whether you praise him or not, whether you worship him or not, if you take the medicine and the instruction given by him, you can get rid of your sickness. This is the nature of the Buddha's message. So we cannot wait until we get everything from heaven. We have to work for it. Kichang atapang akkataro tathagata. This is the Buddha word. The Buddhas can tell you what to do. Because you cannot understand many things, you have a lot of ignorance, imaginations, misconceptions, and misled by others. Therefore, you cannot understand the real truth. Then the method taught by the wise people, noble people, who had no selfish motive, when you follow according to your own experience, you can see the result. But don't depend on Buddha, or simply by worshipping or praying to him to go to heaven or go to Nirvana. He says, I cannot take anybody to heaven. Oh, Nirvana, it is impossible, and there is nobody else who can do that. He says, you have to work for that. If you like, you can pray to anybody, no harm. You are not doing any harm to anybody. You can worship and pray. But don't depend on this. There are certain things you have to do, certain things not to do. The trouble with us, easy for us to do many things, but very difficult not to do. This is the weakness. Whether good or bad, we have to do something. Therefore, we must know what are the things that we should not do. Our religion is needed here for us to understand what we should not do and what we should do. So what to do now? Very easy. You can understand what is right and what is wrong. You make mistakes not because you do not know that they are wrong, but you have no courage to control your mind. When you are tempted, intoxicated with temptation, you have no courage to apply the brake. You can violate any immoral, any cruel or harmful method to gain what you want, to satisfy you. That is our witness. We know even those thugs and gangsters who come and disturb others, they know very well they are doing wrong thing. They are not innocent people. But they have no courage to control their mind to avoid this. Then religion teaches. Other religion teaches you. God is there. If you do such bad things, God will punish you. That is very important. Those who cannot control their mind, that warning is very important. But the Buddha has gone beyond that. He wanted you to understand why it is wrong, why we should stop these things, why we should do these things, without depending on punishment or without thinking on reward. Now then, realizations appear in the mind. If you think of only your punishment or reward, there is no realization in the mind. Why it is bad, why it is good. Because you need you a chance to analyze and understand. Always think of your punishment, think of your reward. That's all. Otherwise, no religion for you. You can do anything whatever you like. If there is no punishment, if there is no reward. But here, the Buddha's way is, when you use your mind, don't think that you cannot understand, but you are so lazy to think, lazy to study, lazy to analyze. Always depend on somebody. Wherever you remain like this, no realization, no understanding. So now we know. Whatever we gain, when you see the whole world, we can understand there is no satisfaction, there is no contentment, there is no peace. Then everybody is shivering with fear. Every human being is in fear all over the world. Who is responsible for this? Who created this? Don't blame God or devil. Human mind, untrained human mind, create this miserable situation. This is the danger of human mind. If the mind is not disciplined properly, this human mind can destroy the whole world. Before God come and destroy, or devil come and destroy, the man will do the job. He has discovered enough things to do that. He is ready now. See how clever, what sort of development. That is what Bertrand Russell says. How can we believe that human beings are more superior to human, the animals? Because animals have never discovered such thing to destroy this world. Therefore, humans respect animals. We, human beings who have religion, who have wonderful scientific knowledge, who knows everything under the sun and moon, discovered many things to destroy the whole world, every living thing in this world. Then where is the development?
What sort of development? For what purpose? To destroy. Man is destroying the world and the earth and the air and the water and other living beings. Where is the development? And immoral activities have become very, very common. That is also development. Cruelty and cunningness also so advanced. When you compare modern human life and the primitive man's way of life, primitive men were innocent. They had to struggle for their survival, that's all. We are very advanced. We think we are cultured and civilized, or we have realized religions. We have discovered God, therefore we are advanced. But our behavior, our character, our mental attitude, worse than those primitive men. More cruel, more cunning, more selfish. So there is no end. Then, just now I told you the two reasons what the Buddha tried to explain. I came to this world by realizing the nature of existence and to tell you or make you to understand why you suffer. Who is responsible for your suffering? Nobody else is responsible. You are responsible. Don't blame others. Whenever there is any trouble, any problems, any calamities, you blame others. But you never think you also contributed something for this clash or misunderstanding or calamity. Our egoism is not ready to admit our weakness, our mistake. Always we try to justify ourselves and blame others. This is the nature of human mind. We know very well we are the culprit, we are the one who created this problem. Even then, we are not ready to admit that we have done this. Pretend that we are innocent. The other person is responsible. This is our way of thinking. So the Buddha's advice is, admit that you are responsible for your suffering, nobody else. Then work without depending on others. The method is taught. What to do and what not to do. Then you can see all your mental and physical problems that you are facing today. And you can see the end of all these problems. And that is called salvation. Why every religion use this word salvation or liberation? They too admit we are suffering, we are not happy, we have no satisfaction. The method taught by them according to their respective religions, they teach us. In the end, you gain salvation or liberation or freedom. So we also use the same word, liberation from suffering, freedom from suffering, physical and mental. That is called nirvana. When there are no more mental suffering, when there are no more physical suffering, when there are no more internal or external suffering, that is called nirvana. That is the end of suffering. So the method
Buddha has shown is simple but very difficult to practice because of our weakness. We are not ready to admit our weaknesses, our mistake, our selfishness. If we can admit these things, then there won't be any more problems. Thank you. Two friends from Canada, they are staying in our next door church, Lutheran church. You see, they are very keen to know about the Buddhist way of life and what Buddhists believe and what they do. And so I invited them to come and attend this Friday and Sunday talk during their stay here. The main purpose of coming to this part of the world to study the Buddhist way of life and Hindu's way of life and Islamic way of life, so they can compare with Christianity. So when you study the other man's way of life and religious belief, we can avoid this unnecessary prejudice and jealousy that we develop in our mind regarding other religion by thinking that our religion or my religion is the best religion, all the others are wrong. Some people maintain this attitude because they have no chance to associate with others and discuss with others, to exchange views, and certain things that we can disagree. Friendly, we can agree to disagree without quarreling, without arguing. Frankly, we say, yes, I agree with you to disagree because my religion teaches like this and your religion teaches like this. We too cannot agree. Very good. But we are not enemies. But some people cannot do that. If I cannot agree with you, you think I am your enemy. That is our weakness. Try to tolerate. Try to understand how others believe and practice and maintain their religious way of life. The Buddha's advice is remarkable. I can tell you the name of the book also if you want to know where he said like this, Anguttara Nikaya, Sutra Pitaka. The Buddha says, whenever you find truth anywhere, in any religion, if it is truth, accept. He never said, the truth you can find only in Buddhism. But unfortunately, some others say, truth can be found only in their religion, but not in other religion. That is their weakness.
බුම්මත්තා දේවානාගා මහිද්දිකා පුඤ්ඤන්තං අනුමෝදිත්වා චිරං රක්ඛන්තු ලෝක සාසනං ඉත්තා උතා චම්හෙහි සම්පතං පුඤ්ඤ සම්පතං සබ්බේ දේවා අනුමෝදන්තු සබ්බ සම්පත්ති සිද්ධියා දේවෝ වස්සතු කාලේන සස්ස සම්පත්ති හේතුච පීතෝ භවතු ලෝකෝ ච රාජා භවතු ධම්මිකෝ ඉදං වූ ඥාති නං නෝතු සුඛිතා හොන්තු ඥාතයෝ ඉමිනා පුඤ්ඤ කම්මේන මාමේ බාල සමාගමෝ සතං සමාගමෝ හොතු යාව නිබ්බාන පත්තියා.